Fragen vom Dorf oder?
Ja. Das heißt, muss ich das Zentrum oder das heißt?
Ja, und vielleicht muss man das Zentrum machen. Ja.
Das ist gut.
Good. Broad camera. Rolling. Mick, can you be so kind and recall when did you for the first time meet Freddie Mercury? Maybe he was then called still Freddie Bulzara or Freddie Mercury.
No, he was, I didn't meet him until he was part of Queen. I had the connection was really through Trident, who were not only the studio, but they were a production company that had signed Queen and were managing them. And there was a guy called Ken Scott who used to work with David Bowie. And obviously, and he was part of Trident as well. So they had expressed to him a desire to meet me, to work with me, because they were big fans of, especially David and Lou Reed. And that's how it came about. So it must have been the late summer, autumn of 73. They'd already had their first album out, and but it didn't. I didn't know anything about it, and it certainly didn't make any impact in England. But I was told they were a lively bunch, and that I'd be entertained to meet them, and so I went along for a chat. And of course, I was very entertained. They were a very lively bunch. Well, three of them were very lively, anyway. I was very impressed with them, I must say. One, the music, which for the very first time they played me, that was the first time I'd ever heard the music, but also their attitude. They were very non-traditional rock and roll band by the standards of the time. For one thing, they were intellectually sharper than most of the people I'd been dealing with before. In terms of bands, I mean, David Bowie and Lou Reed are pretty sharp too, but bands tended to have that down thing, you know, that, and also they were very hip for guys who hadn't thus far made much of an impact on the business. And Freddie, I figured out pretty early on, was the one who would make the most noise about the visuals. Even though he, Brian and Roger, as, and I'm sure that continued to the end, that was pretty much a democratic way of making decisions, Freddie, I got the vibe early on, was the one who might make a little bit more fuss. Plus he had named the band and he had done the logos. So, and he and I had a lot of tastes in common, not least things like Oscar Wilde and Aubrey Beardsley and, should we say, the decadent deal that was in the air at the time. I actually met them up at Trident Studios, I believe, which is in Soho, in St Anne's Court it was in those days, anyway. So that was my very first encounter with Queen.
And your sort of your early impressions on this guy, Freddie Mercury, now leave alone the band situation, but what did you think?
Well, he's very likable, and he was very, florid. He was very expressive in his attitude, and that appealed to me. I liked that. David Bowie was my friend, and Freddie was like one step beyond David in terms of how campy he was. So that appealed to me. Obviously, that was very much in the air at the times. It was the androgynous thing, the bisexual vibe, the decadent thing. That was, and Freddie definitely epitomized that. And plus, he acted like he was a star. And of course, you know, he was not. But he was in his own mind, and I came to believe that he and the band had the talent to become stars. So my attitude was very much from the beginning to treat them like that. But it was definitely, he was always, the way he was, people that got to know him once he indeed became very famous and a star. He didn't really change. He was like that, and it's on record from, I think, I'm sure the rest of the band talk about it too. He was always like that. Even when he was living in this little flat on the Holland Road in London with Mary. And he used to invite me around for tea. I'd go around. From the beginning, we got to be very friendly, and of course it was always tied in with the work, but he and I shared a lot of tastes in common, so it was an easy relationship to slip into.
And how would, when you would, you know, come by for tea at the place, I mean, can you describe
well, you mean
a little bit?
Yeah. Like Freddie would always be in his dressing gown for a start, his dressing gown with his slippers on. It was very domesticated little scene, very, very friendly. I mean, Freddie was, when you got Freddie on his own, he as I found out very early on, he was really quite a, he was quite an empathetic and much more low-key than when he was on for, whenever there was two or three people in a room, he became something else. But in from the beginning, he was a very sweet man. I mean, you know that, you work with him. This is a genuinely nice guy by any standards. So, but tea would be literally tea, and he loved to gossip. He always loved to gossip. He wanted to know about David and Lou Reed and ins and outs and intricate things about their lives. And but he also, I remember, he had quite a broad taste in music, including not only John Lennon, but also Joni Mitchell, which of course was a surprise at first. I remember that maybe was a little later when he maybe 74. When Court and Spark came out, but that was a record he played all the time. And the other thing I remember him being very obsessive about was the painter, I believe it's Richard Dadd. Mm-hmm. He wrote that song, the fairy, what do you call it, Masterstroke. That was all about him. So tea time with Freddie was quite a little friendly little domestic affair, in fact.
What was the sort of the cultural climate in London around these early days when you met Freddie? I mean, well, how would
high androgyny? I would say it was definitely boys. You had the most fun if you were a boy that looked a bit like a girl. I mean, I used to wear eye makeup and a bit of rouge and a little bit of lip gloss. I was pretty much embraced by the whole thing, and so Freddie fit in pretty much, you know, he was very much part of his times, I would say. And the others, to a slightly lesser extent, because Roger and Brian and John were not intrinsically so camp as Freddie. But Freddie, the thing that struck me about Freddie was he was an interesting mixture of someone who was absolutely confident of his talent, but also that he had, that he was also very insecure, not about his talent, but clearly, you know, as one came to realize in his personal life, because that was something that was not quite fully resolved at that time, because obviously he lived with Mary. It wasn't that he didn't like ladies, it's just he hadn't fully come out of the closet at that point, although it wouldn't have mattered to me anyway. He was fairly straightforward with me, but it was not something that he overtly declared to the world at that point. I think that only really came about when Bohemian Rhapsody hit. But he was a special kind of guy. Whether he'd become famous and successful or not, he would have been very memorable, that's for sure.
How was this early relationship between Mary and Freddie? What did you sort of get to know about it?
Very domesticated. They were like a little married couple. I mean, she looked after Freddie, but he was very considerate towards her. I mean, obviously, in the end, he was, you know, he knew that she was someone who always looked out for him, and obviously, the final gesture proved that he knew that. But very sweet, clearly very in love with Freddie, and I would have said he was definitely in love with her too. Whatever there might have been going on the sexual level, and you know, wasn't in the bedroom with them, so I don't know all the lurid details. But whatever was going on, clearly that was a love affair. It was something that was wasn't a situation that I would have thought was one just of convenience. They were clearly very, very close, and he clearly cared about her a lot, absolutely.
You said Freddie clearly liked ladies.
He certainly was comfortable with women. I mean, I saw it, there was, you know, I have known all kinds of people in my life, as indeed one does get to know. And obviously, I tended to attract, because of my associations, a lot of very feminine kind of men. But I never saw Freddie be anything but very open and very, even quite intimate with women, in terms of his rapport. Unlike some people maybe who tend to have gayer leanings, who maybe aren't always so comfortable. Freddie was always comfortable with a woman, even in terms of touching, hugging. He was truly a product of the times. I mean, he was clearly bisexual. Let's put it like that. I think later on, maybe that particular part of his life, the gay thing became more exaggerated and more overt. Although I gather he was, even later on, he was never exclusively gay. So obviously that's a harder road to travel in the final analysis. It's one thing when you're young to muck about, but as you get older, it's obviously easier for most people to define themselves as either straight or gay. And although Freddie decided that he was gay rather than straight, I think there was always some ambivalence about it. I don't think he was just gay anyway, let's put it like that.
I mean, do you think to what extent, because he obviously was very much interested in the David Bowies and the Lou Reeds and that whole, style at the time of the early 70s was, interesting stars, were they gay or not gay?
Oh, yes, that was the big guessing game, yes. So who did it with whom? Yes, who went with boys, who went with girls, when was it all mixed up together? Well, that was the spirit of the times, absolutely. I mean, one thing, the whole gay thing, the whole gay revolution, if you like, started in the early 70s, and obviously it was something that was very hip at the time. But specifically the bisexual thing, the androgynous, the boy-girl, the he-she, the ambiguity, that was the spirit of the time. And Freddie was right in the middle of that, spiritually, emotionally, sexually. And he was clearly a man of his times.
I mean, how much of that was sort of, quotes, image, and how much of that was actually lived by the stars of the Freddies, the Bowies, and the Lou Reeds?
Well, I'm not in the business of going too deeply into my intimate knowledge of these people, which I obviously do have. In certain cases, it may have been more for show. In certain other cases, I don't know that I want to get too specific about certain people, but obviously it did influence Freddie, but I think Freddie. I don't think it was just a show. I mean, Brian and Roger may have looked like little girls too, but clearly they were not. I never saw anything in them that manifested any sort of gayness. I don't think that in Roger's case, I would say absolutely the other way. But he still looked like a little girl. Oh. But that was the key to the times. I mean, if you wanted to have fun with a lady, then the more femme you looked at that time, the better it was. Believe me, I worked every which way I could. So, I understood. Spiritually, I felt very comfortable with them, and obviously, especially with Freddie. So, Freddie was a man of his times, I would say, above all, definitely.
He fitted in there, perfect. Good one. Could you a little bit describe to those maybe younger viewers? You had an amazing clientele at the time of the probably most important pop stars, rock stars. Could you just tell us sort of how did that start with you, and whom also did you do at this late 60s, early 70s, and why do you think did you enjoy this kind of palette of I mean, why did they all come to and wanted to be photographed by you?
Well, I think a lot of it, as in life, things turn out to be, a lot of it was timing, but also I had the right kind of sensibility. I came out of a kind of a student hippie thing, and obviously there was a certain amount of psychedelic drugs involved, and there was a lot of free love, you might say. I mean, the sexual revolution was in full flight in the late 70s, in the late 60s, early 70s. And I was right there, right place, right time, right attitude, right name. You know, my name helped too, I'm sure. And obviously, when I look back, I realized the right sort of talent. But Syd Barrett was probably the first of my key subjects. And he had a very androgynous look. In fact, now all the pictures from the Madcap Laugh sessions, you look, he's wearing quite heavy eye makeup. And that, again, there was a... on, if you like, you know, a word that wasn't used at the time, but became very popular later, on the cutting edge, the feminization of the male was like a revolutionary statement. And I think this glam thing, which it was caught up in, obviously when I met David Bowie, it came into full focus. I kind of rode with him as he rose. When I first saw David, there was maybe 300 people at the show. So he had some kind of following, but not a very big following. And as David's cachet rose, so did mine, and that opened all kinds of doors. I mean, there wasn't a drag ball in London at the time that I didn't get an invite to, believe you me. So I was very comfortable with, I was probably much more comfortable with ambiguous gentleman than I was with more traditional, I don't know what the word would be, but
macho
or yeah, the traditional kind of male. So, but again, it grew out of the hippie thing. It became more entertaining when it segued into the glam thing. It was more dressing up, there was more makeup, the feminization process went that much further, and then it became very, very hip. And the key word is androgynous, rather than gay or even bisexual. The fact, the feminization of the male, and that was my sensibility at the time. Although, you know, in lots of ways, I was still very much a boy, as indeed we all were. But I was probably what you'd call quite a soft boy myself in those days. So.
Was it expressing the freedom also of doing that?
I think it was the idea, the adventure of it was that it was kind of a revolutionary thing. It was a statement. If you walked down the street all tarted up, you got reaction from everybody. And there was a huge cachet for, you know, the hip of the times to looking. For starters, for looking androgynous, and it's hard to explain to people today. You would remember, obviously, because you remember platform heels too. But it was a statement. One made a statement. One could upset people. You know, the hippie thing had peaked out, and just being a hippie was sort of passé. If you wanted to upset people and get people at it and get people talking, then you really needed to be like a boy that looked like a girl. And I slotted right in there. I'll show you a few pictures when I was a young girl. So they were very exciting times. And I don't know what I can't really speak for other people necessarily, but I think we thought we were special in some way. And the special thing was discovering the duality of our personality, understanding the feminine side as well as the masculine side. And
Did the likes of like David Bowie or Lou Reed care a lot about what you did with Freddie Mercury? I'm sure Freddie cared a lot about what you did with Bowie or Lou Reed or Iggy Pop.
I remember introducing Lou to Freddie one night. It was quite early on, must have been in 74. And I know Lou didn't have a clue who they were, but he was, and Lou is Lou. I mean, Lou's an interesting character and always was by any standards. So I remember Freddie being very excited about it, but Lou was the way Lou always was, which was kind of slightly suspicious. And but I remember having introduced them later on, I played Lou the music, and he was very impressed with the music and was quite surprised to realize that the guy I'd introduced him to a week or so before was the singer in this band Queen, who at that, as I say, at that moment in time were not known. And I remember him saying, wow, just on the basis of the singer alone, this band will probably make something real happen. And he, by then, had the hit with Walk on the Wild Side, so he had surfaced, if you like, from the underground, where he had long languished, ignored by all and sundry until David came along. And of course, the miraculous, wonderful, multi-talented Mr. Bowie helped a lot of people. And I know that he and Freddie had some. I wasn't there for it, but I remember when Queen first started to hit, David saying, David being very pleasantly surprised that suddenly all this had happened. I don't know if he knew the others or not, but Freddie was the one that mostly people would tend to react to. He was the most overt personality, and socially he was the one who would who had the most charisma.
What would was there some relationship between David Bowie and Freddie?
Well, I think they had met at a point originally before David had started to hit. In fact, I think they had met in the days when Roger and Freddie had a stall at Kensington Market. But this wasn't a topic of conversation really between me and David until Queen, probably until Seven Seas of Rye, which came off the Queen 2 album. And of course later they did the incredible Under Pressure, which has always been one of my favorite records. Obviously at that moment in time, you couldn't be any hipper than David Bowie and Lou Reed, and Queen were, they wanted it. That was one thing that was clear with them, that this was a band of great overt ambition. And obviously they had the stuff to realize these ambitions. And then it was, to those that were really initiated into Queen, I think it was fairly obvious. I remember the first session I ever did with them was what I call the nudie sessions. In fact, of course, they all had, you know, they weren't standing there stark naked, but because they rolled their trousers way down low, it looked like they were naked. And I remember they got a lot of these pictures before, this was before Queen 2 came out. These pictures did get some reaction in the press, and the press went to town on them, and they really gave them some flack for these extremely feminine, gay-looking pictures. I mean, what can one say? I look at them today, they do look like a bunch of little poofters, you know? And I know Freddie loved it, and the other members of the band weren't always necessarily quite so up on it. I remember there were some discussions, but it did get reaction. Those pictures did get a lot of reaction, and of course, fortunately, Queen had the thing to live up to the outrageousness of the pictures. But I remember the press got down on them. I think the press used to get down on them a lot, mostly because they were, and again, this came more out of Freddie than any of them. They were so expansive and so florid, and so and of course the whole band got lumped in this vibe because Freddie was the key element at that moment in time, although creatively obviously they were always very much a group.
Question? No. but I mean, that's a good point. The rock press didn't seem to like Queen similar like they liked, you know, Sid or Bowie or Iggy or Lou or the Rocky Horror Picture Show, other projects you did. Queen always had a hard time in the beginning with the rock press. Why was that?
Maybe because they were a band, or maybe because there was a sense that they were trying to jump on a wagon, because they came just a few minutes later than the others. But certainly they were up for working it. They wanted to work. They were very, again, you're talking about only Freddie in the band really being truly an androgynous personality, although the others looked it. But they were game, that's for sure, for making a statement. And that's the reason they came to me. They wanted to be, they wanted to upset people. They wanted to outrage people. They wanted to get people clacking about it. And they did. But they were, I think the other thing was they didn't seem to rise up from the underground, as it were. In the case of, say, David, Iggy, Lou, they'd all been lurking about for a while before they actually hit and were in 72 and 73, whereas Queen seemed to come out of nowhere. And I think because of that, they were unfairly labelled as people that were trying to cash in. But, I mean, Freddie was always Freddie. And you look at other pictures, earlier pictures of Freddie, the fact that they only got started to hit in 74 didn't matter. He'd been the way he had been for years. He'd never been any different. So, and Roger and Brian and John were always cute. So that was just the way they came out of the womb.
In what way do you think had something had to do that he was coming? He was an ex-art school student. Was that sort of added that to the way that he and you worked together in a way?
It may be. I mean, a lot of characters in England, it's almost a tradition in England, interestingly enough, and of course it's quite well documented. People like John Lennon, Keith Richards, David Bowie, they all came out of art school. So Freddie was in a strong tradition at that point in time. But yes, Freddie was visually already quite sophisticated, and he was... because that was, you've got to remember that Brian and John particularly were very cerebral. These are guys who ended up, I believe, getting MAs and PhDs and stuff. And Roger had trained to be a dentist. So Freddie tended to guide the band in those early days in terms of the visuals. And certainly he was the one who would make the most noise if he wanted his own way. I think with the music, it was... You know, it was thrashed out between them. With the visual thing, if Freddie made enough noise, he could tend to get his own way. Because I remember this shot, which I remember going to. I remember they came to me and they had wanted, we'd done a couple of sessions, and then we started to talk about the album cover. And they said to me, Mick, it's got to be a gatefold. This is a band that hadn't sold any records, but they were already in their demanding gatefold. The theme has to be black and white, and we want to look absolutely spiffing. So that was my brief, and at that time, around that time, I got to know this gentleman called John Cabal, who is, unfortunately, he died a few years ago, but his collection lives on. He has possibly the best collection of old Hollywood stills in the world. And in those days, it was still early days for him, but he already had a great collection. And I had gotten to know him, and I did a photo session for him for one of his books. And in exchange for that, he gave me a bunch of prints from his collection. And one of them was a shot of Marlene Dietrich taken on the set of Shanghai Express like this. And it was, you know, it was a moment... Maybe chemically induced. It was like Sartori. I remember I got hold of a little book on the life of Marlene Dietrich, which actually John had written, and taking it to a Queen gig somewhere in some godforsaken town in the middle of England, and taking Freddie aside one night. Maybe they were touring with Mott the Hoople. That would make sense, timing-wise, whom I also worked with at that time. So I went out for a couple of dates, took this book with me, took Freddie to one side and said, this, get the four of you, this is the shot, I believe, this is the cover. He then went in and did the sell on the band. And they were up for it. And of course we did this wild session. We did it all in one day. We did the black shots and we did the white shots. And at the time we did them, even though Freddie and I always were pushing for this to be the cover, it was agreed that no decision would be made until we saw the results. And in truth, right up till the last minute, the white shots, the inside cover, there was always a chance that might end up being the cover. I think, as I recall it, and I can't recall a statement from any of the other members of the band, but they felt a little uncomfortable. I think it looked too strong in a way. It was, I think, the word pretentious, which had already been thrown about them, especially because of these nudie pictures. They were pretentious was a word that was used a lot about Queen in the early days. Of course, for Freddie, he didn't give a damn. He thought, yeah, well, we are. We're pretentious. Big fucking deal. It certainly didn't intimidate him, but the other members of the band were a little bit more sensitive to criticism, and they thought maybe this picture was too pretentious. Of course, when it came down to the wire, Freddie went in and battered them around, and they went along with it. And the white shot ended up, of course, on the inside of the centerfold. And of course, that was one of the best decisions they ever made. And that was, you know, probably my most important contribution to the Queen legacy was that particular session. Even though I did a lot of different stuff and I think a lot of great stuff, but that session was the key session, obviously, in their career. And then later on, they adapted it a couple of years later for Bohemian Rhapsody, and which promoted the shot, and it lives on today as one of the the key images of rock and roll. So, but obviously no one had a clue at the time. We were just doing what we wanted to do, and Freddie and I were just hustling our vision. So that was the word, though, pretentious. There was a lot of flack they got for being pretentious, but you know what critics are like. I mean, what the fuck do they, any of them, know, really? I mean, if they could, they would. Instead, they sit around looking for things to criticize. And Queen were right there, very out there, very overt. And I do think it was, I think that, in retrospect, people have talked to me about this. I think it was the two elements. One was that they hadn't, in a sense, paid their dues, whereas David, Lou and Iggy had clearly paid their dues. And two, they came out of nowhere, you know. And two, they came just a little after the very big wave of glam. But obviously, you know, time has proven that this is one of the great bands of all time. I mean, if you had to rank the top half a dozen bands in the history of rock and roll, Queen would be right in there. Forgetting about record sales, and I'm sure they rank up there too. But definitely, you could speak about them in the same breath, I believe, as the Stones and Led Zeppelin and Floyd. I mean, who else would you talk about up there?
Beatles.
Well, the Beatles, obviously, and they're sort of apart, partly because they stopped performing so early on. So they're sort of separate. But in terms of working bands, they rank right up there with the very finest, with Britain's finest, in fact. So,
what does it mean? Describe the your job or function, especially in those days.
I think I'm definitely in the mythology business, and I think I always had a sense of that. I was never that concerned about gritty reality, always much more concerned about aura, always much more concerned about myth and legend. Partly that may be my own background, which, I went to Cambridge, I studied modern languages, sex, drugs, and rock and roll at Cambridge. That was what I ended up studying, maybe more than the modern languages, but the modern languages meant that I studied a lot of characters and personalities, especially people like the mad French poets of the late 19th century in Paris, like Goethe, which is a whole other thing, like Baudelaire, Rimbaud, Nerval, Gautier. These were people that that obsessed me. And I think I tended to gravitate towards people that had that same sort of echo, that same kind of mythological, degenerate echo. That was what excited me. That was what turned me on. And that was what I wanted to see in these people. And in fact, of course, they fulfilled that desire in me quite well. And Freddie clearly was a character who would have done fabulously in either as a pre-Raphaelite or in 19th century Paris, as indeed David, Lou, Iggy, Sid Barrett. These are all people that would have thrived in the kind of bohemian creative environment, either in London or in Paris, of those years. And then you can go back to Sturm und Drang, and that's a whole other thing. But I was steeped in that, you see. So that's what I brought to the table, was a sensibility that had been, that was loaded up with all these mad poets and writers, especially, not really painters and not so much music. They were always the poets and the writers. And that's how I saw these people, through that particular prism. And I look at my work today, and especially in retrospect, and I see it there, I see it clearly. That's, you know, this picture is like a bohemian or a symbolist influence to it, as well as the Hollywood, you know, the Hollywood sense. So somewhere I brought together the glamour of Hollywood with the bohemian fin de siècle vibe of the particular people that I'm talking about. So I'm in the mythology business, and I still am. That's what interests me, not the truth, or not the mundane truth, but a truth that's just more exciting and more fun. And obviously it comes from the talent, so it comes from the talent, and in those days, the beauty of these people. These were all people that, when you know, I look at my pictures and go, wow, this was a good-looking bunch of people I had access to as well. This was not a bunch of, you know, a bunch of gnarly dwarves that I had to pretend were fabulous. They were fabulous. I just got to work on it, you know, maybe the way a sculptor gets to work, and make them just that little bigger than life, or bring the image in line with the talent. So it's inspired by the talent, inspired by the look, inspired by the times. We're in the mythology business.
Wasn't it also quite good that they were all quite intelligent and bright people?
I mean, well, I think that was maybe another factor too. Yeah, I wasn't getting down with, although I did work with some, you know, some less articulate people, because a boy had to make a living and no one was paying. Didn't matter who it was. Believe me, I didn't get paid much money for all that stuff. Today, I make, you know, a lot of money off that stuff. But at the time, all that material, I wasn't getting paid very much. Between you and me, I mean, maybe the Queen album cover, in which I was the art director, the designer, I physically did the layout, I conceived of the cover, maybe I got 300 quid. Of course, 300 quid in 1974 is worth a lot more today, but even so, it wasn't... I wasn't going to retire on that money.
And it was not for the money that you did?
No, I came out of, again, out of that kind of hippie mentality, and I think if I'd stood back and said, what do you want to be, mate? I probably would have been a lyric writer, probably, which would have been, but instead I got to work out my mad poet thing in a whole other way, and photography, I kind of wandered into photography, you know, on an acid trip. But that's a whole other story. But that's how I started out, not by wanting to emulate David Hemmings in Blow Up, but It was a way for me to connect with people that interested me, and then through that I became what I became. But that wasn't what I had in mind at the beginning. I didn't have a lot in mind, because you certainly couldn't think about I'll be a rock and roll photographer. You know, that was a career. I don't bloody think so, man. You know. I know my parents, I think they thought I was completely looped, you know, they didn't get it at all, and I understand in retrospect. I mean, later on, over the years, I met young people say, I want to be like you, I want to be a rock and roll photographer. Well, you could make a living, but at the time, of course, there are a few people, now I look around from today's perspective, and there was a little band of people in different parts of the world who were doing the same thing as I was doing, but you're only talking about at most a couple of dozen people, so there was no role model for what I was doing in a way. The fashion photographer, but I didn't give as it happened, I took a lot of pictures that were fashionable, but I didn't give a bugger about that. They were the trappings. I was interested in the soul. I was interested in the poetry. I was interested in the sex. I was interested in the drugs. But that's what formed my sensibility, my teenage obsessions with mad poets and mad artists and mad writers.
What was the fascinating part of Freddie for you then?
I think connecting with the quieter, sweeter. I mean, there's a man with a big heart, you got to understand. This is a man that, once he opened the door to you, was a very generous spirit. Even if he didn't have anything, which he didn't in the early days, this was a very giving person. I think I was always turned on by, when you first meet somebody, as when one first met Freddie, it's very elaborate, very rococo. The whole personality, and as you get to know him a little bit more, you find out that this is also a sweet guy. He likes to sit home, have a cup of tea, hang out, have a bit of gossip, play with the cat. I mean, a very human person always. As obsessed as he was by his career, this was a man who always had time for people that he felt accepted him for what he was. I think that was the key with Freddie. If you accepted him for being what he was, he could open up to you. He was a very gentle man. He was just a great, sweet person. And as much as the operatic Freddie, that was Freddie too, there was also this slightly lost, but very bright, very sensitive, very empathetic personality in there. This was a very rich personality by any standards, and I think anybody that got a little close to Freddie at any time will tell you the same thing. I can't believe they won't, you know.
How was, could you tell us a little bit about the working situations when you had sessions, photo sessions? How much would he count?
I remember most about Queen, though, was, and even though the others were not, you know, the bisexual element was a pose rather than a reality, I remember how we had to stop and start all the time, because they were always in the bloody mirror, just checking their makeup. I remember we had a mirror for every, I mean, normally I don't have a mirror around, and I learned later on, put my foot down, because that gets in the way. But you had to have a mirror. So they were very obsessed with looking adorable, let's put it like that. And I remember that shot, the famous shot. I had to be up on a ladder, I had to get them in the right angles, and just as I'd be ready to shoot, somebody would be worried about a pimple somewhere, or we'd have to stop and get the makeup artist, bring a mirror. So there was a lot of fussing about that went on. They were quiet, and I think this is the way they work in the studio. They're always a little bit of bickering, a little bit of complaining, a little bit of you know, let's try this, let's try that. They were very open for experiment, I will say that. Not necessarily in what was used, but in what was shot. You know, I do have material that hasn't been seen at all because, you know, when we shot it, they decided maybe it wasn't so interesting after all. But they did, above all, want to be in control of their destiny. There was no, as the similarity, say, between them and Lou and David and Iggy and these personalities was that the management was very much to the side. I didn't own the record company. And like I say, Queen, no one knew who the hell they were. But they, from the beginning, this is what we want. This is not what, if we like it, it goes. They would fight, they would scrap to get what they wanted. They certainly weren't interested in anybody else's opinion about something. So that, for me, has always been the favorite way to work directly with the spirit of the artist. Forget every other consideration. If they love it, it works. It's great. And of course, we got fabulous results.
So, session memories?
Oh, session memories. Well, let's see, because we can't talk about everything.
But what sessions do you recall at all? You said the first one was the sort of what you called
the nudie one, yes. Mm-hmm. And of course, there are ones with the, that thing with the crown on top. I've got those pictures there. I remember Freddie bringing in all this.
I mean, this
the scepter. Is it a scepter?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Sorry.
I remember there was a lot of talking went on. It was hard to get them to shut up. That was one thing. You know, some people don't have a lot to say, and maybe it's better that they don't. These guys were always fussing about something. So they were a very busy lot, even though they were very inexperienced. I mean, when I took them in for that, quote, the nudie session, I don't think they'd ever done a studio session before. I think a guy called Douglas Paddyfoot had done some stuff, but it was like in Freddie's apartment or Brian's apartment, but they were not, they hadn't had any very sophisticated results. So it was a big move in that sense. Not that I had, you know, not I had only been around about 3 years by the time I first met them. I wasn't, hadn't, was not, you know, it wasn't like I've been working for years in the studio. So, but still, they were complete ingenues when it came to a photo session. But they were fun. They were always fun. They liked, I'm trying to think what sort of music we played. I think we played a lot of Queen music for a start. They're very obsessed with their own music. David Bowie, Lou Reed, Led Zeppelin. They were very big on Zeppelin, of course. And in a way, I think it's probably fair to say that certainly the early Queen, I think the best description I ever saw was, you know, Led Zeppelin meets Ziggy Stardust. And of course, it was a winning combination.
Is there a favorite picture of Freddie that you took?
There is one that I actually took in his, because I actually did a fair bit of shooting in his apartment too, in the apartment that he shared with Mary. There's one where he has you can see like a white zigzag across his face. He's got a white vase to his side. Hasn't been seen very much. It did get used once, not at the time, but a little bit later, I think, a night at the opera, because he looked like the Phantom of the Opera. I think Disc magazine ran it and said the Phantom of the Opera. But other than that, that's a picture that's not been seen so much over the years. But of course, this one, the group stuff is fabulous, but the solo of Freddie is probably one of my all-time favorite pictures, and certainly it's one of the key pictures in my oeuvre, you might say. So,
how did working with Freddie, did that change your life in some way?
Well, I think it helped fuel my life. Certainly Freddie's enthusiasm was key. There was another thing with Freddie that I remember that was something that always came up. One is he did not want to be photographed smiling. He had a thing about his teeth. And as it transpired, apparently he had four extra, beyond the wisdom teeth, Freddie had an extra set of teeth. So he was, in a sense, a freak of nature in that way. And I remember talking to him about it, saying, well, why don't you get it fixed? Because it gave him that look of the overbite, and he was very self-conscious about that. But he always believed that the extra teeth in there gave him more resonance to his voice, so he would never have them taken out. So he didn't like the slightly Bugs Bunny effect that it would have if he didn't look out. But he wouldn't do anything about it. So that was always something. I don't think you'll find that, and it's probably true of all the other pictures. There aren't many pictures, that certainly aren't any pictures of Freddie with a big, fat smile on his face. And that was the reason why, because he was very concerned to disguise that slight visual impediment from the camera. So that was something we would have to start and stop a bit, and he liked to keep a check of that.
Cut it for a moment. Can we give... okay, roll camera. Do you know what Mary Austin was like before she started going out with Freddie? Did you know her before?
No, I didn't. But I know she used to... at the time I met her, she was working at Bieber's. So she was a very homely kind of person. Very glamorous little lady, but in her personality was very quite self-effacing, I would have said. She wasn't, this wasn't some kind of groupie, you know, I mean, far from it. She had known Freddie for a while and probably, from my understanding, was the first love of his life, and in many ways the last love of his life, of course, because she looked after him at the end. I mean, she came back into his life. But I remember her just being a very sweet, absolutely very well-behaved, very polite, very good-natured, but essentially a self-effacing personality, not somebody who wanted to put herself forward. She was always somebody who was happy to defer to Freddie, to let Freddie have all the attention. She never seemed to mind the fact that she was in the shadow. This wasn't unlike, say, an Angela Bowie, who would desperately fight to be in the spotlight too. That was the last thing she was interested in. And I never saw them argue. I must say, I know with Roger had a girlfriend that he was always arguing with. Unbelievable. But I can't remember her name. Very cute little girl, I remember she was. But they were always arguing. She hated it when they started to get a lot of attention. But Mary, she never minded. She always accepted that Freddie... she was treating him like a very special person, and they were very sweet. They were like a little married couple. This was obviously true love. You know, I have no doubt about that. Whatever the ambiguities of Freddie's persona and clearly of his sexual personality, nevertheless, this was true love. And I have seen interviews with him done in the 80s where he still states that she's probably the person in his life that he trusts most. So this was, in a sense, whatever was going on, especially later on with the boys, ultimately, I think it's probably fair to say that she was the love of his life. And clearly, he left the estate to her. So in his heart, I don't know where his groin was at, but where his heart, in his heart, she was the love of his life, and she was always a great person.
She said that Freddie opened her eyes to life, to many aspects of.
Yeah, she deferred to him. He was the one who was infinitely curious about everything. I think she was not so curious about life. She was just by nature a nurturing personality, even though she was a cute little dolly bird at the time. She was. He was the adventurer, and she was prepared just to be his companion. And I never got the sense she was ever looking for anything other than to be with Freddie, to look after Freddie, to be nice to his friends. This was a great person, and still is to this day, in fact.
You mentioned that through work, but also through semi-private meetings, obviously Freddie developed, and I remember that being the same thing with our work, some sort of companionship, even friendship, although being careful with the word. Is there any side of his personality that you recall which is not so obvious to the public, which would be interesting to state or to tell about?
Well, like what, Lloyd? What would be?
No, I mean, for example, at the time I met him, he was a perfect host. He was always taking care a lot of, you know, that everybody has everything, and I'm not talking about any sensational things. But
right.
Is there anything that comes into your mind in these early days that you know, was he? What kind of pictures did he like, or paintings? Do you remember, or kind of?
Well, he
did
was
talking about poetry with him. Or
yeah. Well, no, he. I mean, he loved Aubrey Beardsley. Which that was, I remember we sitting just flicking through books of Aubrey Beardsley at the time. He had a strong feeling for the pre-Raphaelites. He, like me, was very obsessed with the late 19th century. In his case, more with English, with the art like Rossetti or Millais. So he was very curious, I would say, and he was someone who I observed, generally speaking, he was really quite a private person. This was not his life wasn't an open book, but again, if he got to know you, he had a very generous spirit. I think he was he was less maybe obsessed by the poets than he was by the artists. Again, he came out of art school. So, but that was his favorite period, late 19th century English art. What was the other guy? Edward Burne-Jones was the other guy that we both. So that was something that gave us a lot to talk about and look at books and have another cup of tea. And maybe a little something else, but
was he? Did he want to look like Marlene Dietrich also? But was it just a gesture that he liked?
No, I think he understood that he was Freddie. But he, the idea. Well, I think for a start, Marlene Dietrich was a very stylized person, and Freddie understood that stylization made it easier for a public to relate to you directly, if you could strip it down to an essential image. And I think that's when he saw that picture, when I showed him that picture. Yeah, he said, oh yes, I should be Marlene Dietrich. I mean, Freddie wasn't, he did dabble around in drag, but I don't think he's, I don't really see Freddie up on stage, you know, being Marlene Dietrich. And I've had a lot of friends who would literally do that. But of course, God gave Freddie this incredible voice, as well as incredible songwriting talent. So he didn't need that as a means of expressing himself. But yeah, he said, "Oh, I shall be Marlena." I remember, "Oh yes, Mick, this is so perfect. I shall be Marlena." But he related to that. He related to the aura. He related to the star factor. He related to the bigger than life thing. So he did have, he was open in quite a sophisticated way early on, even though he was still learning about how to project himself. Because you see the very early Queen pictures, and they're a little bit, without blowing my own trumpet, I think I did bring to them a sense of style. Not in the way they dress, because they dress the way they dress, but I, in some way, synthesized it. And was able to help them project it at a very key point in their career. So, no, I don't think Freddie wanted to be Marlena, actually. I don't think he actually wanted to be a woman. But he loved, you know, the showbiz, the bigger than life, the amazing aura. Plus, he, like me, he liked just watching her movies. Not because she actually necessarily made the best movies, but she always looked so fucking fabulous, and that was the key to it. Of course, she understood lighting. You see, interestingly enough, and I do remember that. I remember I had this little book that John Cabal wrote, and us flicking through it. I remember showing him the key picture, But he was very fascinated by the fact that very early on, if you see her before Joseph von Sternberg got a hold of her, I'm sure she had some talent, but she was a fairly ordinary, dowdy looking woman until he taught her about lighting and about makeup, and that her eyebrows got lifted. They got shaved off and they were repositioned, and she was transformed into, not quite, I mean, Blue Angel, you start to see it, but when he brought her to America and started on things like Shanghai Express, I mean, and even after she stopped working with him, she always kept control over the lighting. So he did understand that if you could grasp certain key technical elements, that would help project you in the way that you wanted to be projected. And because she had a certain genius to her, without a doubt, and she learned it. This was not a woman who was intrinsically as beautiful as she projected herself. I mean, Madonna learned that, you know. I mean, Madonna in the flesh is, you know, not so interesting, but she understands what to do in front of a camera so that she looks fantastic, much more fantastic than you'd ever believe by seeing her in the flesh. So
so did you from the very start see your role as a sort of, you know,
an image maker?
Yeah,
I think I always saw myself less always as a photographer and more as an image maker. I think that's what obsessed me. The camera was just a convenient tool. It was not a, you know, I wasn't trying to be David Bailey, yes. I was obsessed with imagery that was bigger than life, that's for sure. Not an accurate record of an individual, but trying to synthesize the certain elements that would produce an image that was much, much bigger than life and much more interesting, say, than everyday life. Yes, I'm not really a gritty kind of photographer, you know. Although I got fairly gritty with Iggy because that was what was required, but not with Freddie.
When you look to, for example, you know, this picture, or also certain Bowie pictures, or Iggy Pop, I mean, you were able to do quite a few pictures that were bigger than life, and now in sort of, you know, some 20, 30 years later. Does it make you content with, are you happy?
Well, I'm glad I didn't waste my youth, let's put it like that, because, you know, I was pretty wasted a lot of the time. But it's nice to be able to look back and think that, that I produced. I enjoy it now probably. I think for a long time I tried to run away from it because it was quite a heavy bag to carry around. Now I feel for it in a much lighter way. And of course it's a great pension fund for me. All the money that I blew for so many years is, fortunately, in moments of crisis, I turned around and I was able to make money off this old material, which certainly was not something that I ever dreamed of or thought of at the time. I don't know why it all happened, though. I mean, I have no real understanding of why it did, other than the fact that, you know, it was written upstairs sometime a long time ago.
Because are you now aware that you are sort of quite an important part of rock history, for certain elements of musicians, or for certain spectrum of the?
Well, certainly, if you want to talk about glam, clearly, you know, I did a lot of, again, the punk era. I did a lot of key images too. But by then there were a lot more photographers around. The thing about the glam scene, especially obviously in England, where it had its fullest flowering, was I was really the only person there. And it wasn't that all these other people were battering down the doors trying to get in. No one else was that interested. There wasn't that much money in those pictures when I first started working with all these people. I mean, the Transformer cover, which is, I got 100 quid at the time, and you know what? I was well happy. But so, I can't explain any of it in an intellectual, logical way. I had my antennae were just tuned in the right way for this particular sensibility. Of course, I did have to the fact was that I got known for photographing men that looked a bit like women, you know. But in fact, I take very good pictures of young ladies too. So, you know, I had to. Unfortunately, I have, you know, a body of work, including Debbie Harry, to prove that. But that was something. It was quite a heavy bag that I found, and I did try to get away, especially in the 80s. I did try to forget about it and push it into the background and ignore it, and got into all kinds of other things, including videos and you know, more art directing and packaging and my collage work. But it's one, it's nice to know I'm still alive, because I nearly wasn't 3.5 years ago, and two, it's not, and I think that's changed my attitude. It started when I did that book, the photographic record. I started to learn how to live with the past while getting on with the present. But I have no explanation for any of it, that's for sure. I'm sure if you question David or Lou or Freddie or Iggy or Debbie or any of these people, I'm sure they have no explanation of why they turned out to be. I mean, they are all kind of fabulous creatures. They all transformed into these very exotic creatures, and somehow that was the company that I enjoyed. That was the kind of, because I did a lot of other work around that time too. I mean, I shot an album cover for a group called Geordie. I was watching AC/DC the other night, and there's Brian Johnson. I have great pictures of Brian Johnson, who's the lead singer, taken when he was with this band Geordie. And that was probably all around that same time too. I have great stuff of a guy called Arthur Brown, who this in his second incarnation is Kingdom Come. But one of my best collections of pictures from that period, other than these obviously people that whose image has lingered, whose image and music has lingered so long and has proved to be so classic, is a guy called Lindsay Kemp, who was a mime choreographer, whom David and later a lady called Kate Bush learned all their art from. Now I have the best collection of Lindsay Kemp pictures too. I have, so the glam period, whatever, that I know when in the galleries they say, Mick, what we want to do is sell you as the definitive glam photographer, because those are the pictures. So I've learned to accept that. I think for many years I it irritated me, because it kind of limited me in a certain way. People, but you know, that's, I've had enough years to break through that, and people know that I can shoot anything. But a lot of the time they do come out, even very punky pictures come out with a kind of raw glam element to them. So it's, you know, that is my sensibility, I suppose.
If you would have the chance to, you know, if Freddie would walk in the door tomorrow, is there anything that you would like to say to him, or that you didn't have the chance to tell him when he was?
Well, I'm very the last. I didn't see him. I would see him in New York in the 80s, where he spent a lot of time in New York. Of course, in New York, you could really walk on the wild side. You know, that was why I was here, and clearly why, you know, many other people, including Freddie, were drawn to spend a lot of time here. But I was off on my own tangent the last few years of his life, and I'm just very sorry. I didn't get a chance to say goodbye, and I didn't really know he was sick until somebody from the fan club, like, hinted to me. I think I was having a show at Ronnie Wood's gallery sometime, must have been 89, and she dropped this hint, and that was the first I knew. But by then, I remember trying to get word through, but it got lost somewhere, so, and then suddenly Freddie was dead. So I'm just very, very sorry I didn't get a chance to say goodbye to him, because I would have given him a big, big, big kiss, that's for sure. Told him that he was one of the best, one of the greatest. Let's face it, I mean, that might be the finest voice that ever hit rock and roll when you come down to it. I mean, he could sing opera. I don't think there's anyone else in rock and roll that could sing opera. So he left an amazing legacy. It's just terribly sad that he had to go so soon. I mean, he listened to the last album when he could barely stand most of the time, and the talent was unwavering. I mean, he never lost the beauty, the resonance of that amazing talent.
Would you say that he was a friend?
Yes. I mean, he was quite a close friend in the early years. Once I moved to New York, I have pictures. I've got some Polaroids of us somewhere taken around in the early 80s. So we remained friends because we didn't really take any pictures. I think, you know, there are many reasons for it. You know, maybe because we were used to talk about it, but we were so high on being in New York and the chemicals of the times. And I remember running around with him and having tea at the plaza and flirting with waiters. You know, I mean, I love to tease as well. So so we were very close at one point, and we remained friends, and I don't recall ever a bad word between us about anything. We just lost touch, and it was, I lost touch with a lot of people in the 80s, without getting into all the lurid details as to why. I mean, I had my own thing to explore, and I was trying to get beyond rock and roll, but of course in the end, rock and roll said, fuck you, Mick Rock. This is it. This is what you are. Rock and roll did define me. I think I was trying to escape. I didn't talk not only to him, I didn't talk to David, Lou, Iggy, Debbie, any of those people, but for maybe a period of about, you know, from like the mid-80s to the mid-90s. So, but that's another story. That's the Mick Rock story.
What was Freddie like in New York? Because he had an apartment.
Well, Freddie in New York, I think it's part of the reason why I enjoyed being here. You could be whatever you wanted. New York, you really could, you could get lost in New York. You didn't have to, one thing about New York is no one bothers you. You know, you don't get mobbed on the streets or recognized. I mean, you saw kind of characters. I mean, Bowie, Mick, Keith, see them walking around the streets on their own, you know, not. You could, I think that was the exciting thing. You could go to the wildest clubs, and not be limited by people's expectations of you. You could actually, in a certain way, be yourself, or you could be the extreme part of your personality. And that was what was exciting about New York. Of course, that's what has killed a lot of people over the years, and nearly got me eventually. And I'm sure, you know, it was here that that Freddie contracted the illness that killed him. Because New York, I mean, I don't want to go too far into it, but I do remember some night visits to one or two clubs on the West Side that were very leathery, and there were some, well, Freddie was an adventurer, you know, and I drew certain lines in certain places that I don't think Freddie did, you see. Of course, you know, sexually, intrinsically, I'm heterosexual. Intrinsically, maybe Freddie is gay, or was gay. But we were both interested in blurring the lines. And you could do that in New York, like no other city in the world. In the late 70s and into the 80s, it was really, if you want to talk about decadence, well, this was the place to be truly decadent. Absolutely. I'm sorry, Mother.
If you were with Fred?
Well, I do remember. I remember, I think Tea at the Plaza is one of my favorite memories of Freddie. As both going in there, doled up to the nines. And I remember there was this one particular young waiter there that we cruised unmercifully. And he was after a while he recognized Freddie. At first he didn't know, we were just customers. And then after a while he recognized Freddie. And he actually asked if he was Freddie, and of course we both denied it. No, he was a lookalike who was acting like Freddie. So we gave him this whole little mythology about the situation. I think maybe in retrospect, he said as we were leaving something about, we do look awfully like Freddie, you're the best lookalike I've ever seen. So I think he realized who it was. But I just remember it was the Plaza and how we were not being outrageous in a vulgar way, but we were certainly being outrageous in a very camp way. And that's how I remember Freddie, that you could have a lot of fun with him. I mean, mind you, the waiter was very good looking, I must say. This wasn't just any ordinary looking waiter. I think he actually was a model who was doing this to make a bit of money in his spare time because he hadn't been that successful thus far. But I remember Freddie paid, and I think what clued him into the fact that it might really be Freddie, in spite of our denials, was the fact that he got a tip that was about four times the price of the bill itself. So Freddie was always prepared to pay for his fun, you see. And that was fun for both of us because it didn't cost me anything. So that's that, but it was all pretty harmless, in fact. I don't think, to be quite frank with you, that he was actually Freddie's type, because I don't think Freddie was necessarily into pretty boys particularly. But he liked to look at them, you know. And I've always, you know, I enjoy looking at good-looking men too. Maybe that's because that's one of the last memories I had of Freddie. That was probably sometime around 84, 85.
He had an apartment here in New York for quite some time.
Yes, he did. I remember going to a couple of parties there. He did have the most. He did have the most extraordinary parties. I mean, they. I've seen Roger. You know, I know Queen did. I mean, that naughty Roger. He was a wild one in his time too. Very camp parties. I'm not sure that I should go there though. That's to get too explicit about it. Be like talking about the Anvil as well. You know what the Anvil was?
No.
Oh, this is the most amazing gay club in New York you've ever seen in your life. This, again, that's been closed for a lot of years, but especially in the late 70s and early 80s, that was... I remember seeing, for instance, there was a guy there, that was where Freddie got the look, was the guy that ended up in the Village People. With the moustache, do you remember the Village People? There was a guy there that looked exactly the way with the hats and the shorts and the whole thing. That was where Freddie got the look from. But I think he actually saw him before, because he used to be a dancer on the bars there, before the Village People hit. But I remember going down there then and him being very captivated by this particular gentleman who later showed up in the... And I think he's still in the Village People, in fact, because the Village People... do tour a bit still again to this day, don't they?
Was he ever open to you explaining sort of his turn from a heterosexual loving couple with Mary to a more sort of flexible type of?
Well, I think it had always been there. I mean, I don't know about. I didn't. I know. I remember him telling me, without going into all the details, about an early encounter. Him telling me quite early on about an early about a boy that he had been fascinated by. I don't know if it was ever consummated, but certainly he spoke of this particular guy. I think this probably had been in his late teens. So. But I think there was always that battle that went on inside Freddie, and maybe that's what fueled his ambition and his talent was the battle that went on inside himself. Because I believe, you know, I think there was someone in Germany, a woman, in the 80s, in fact. But again, I never met her, so and I don't know, and I wasn't in the room. So I don't think he was ever like 100% gay, although he might have been 80%, you know. So there was a duality to Freddie. That, I mean, he's not the only one of my friends that I've come across that, you know. One or two of these other characters we've talked about, the same kind of duality. And of course, they're always fascinating people that really have to can't. quite settle one way or the other, you know, the bisexuals. But also they're the probably the most tormented souls. I mean, I have a number of close friends and ones that are, in fact, you know, quite well known that this is a particular battle and that they've had to deal with. Although Freddie never complained about it. I don't recall that as being an issue. But I never felt that he was. I felt he was. Yes, he was very camp. But this was not a. This was not a man who was completely gay. This was always a man who had a certain feeling for women, even sexually, albeit that may have been, you know, time-wise, a lesser facet of his sexual personality. He's a complicated man, definitely a complicated man.
And you think that battle within himself maybe may have produced some of the great songs and art?
Yeah, I mean, you know, listen to Bohemian Rhapsody. I mean, that's, you know, that goes off in all kinds of directions. I think clearly. But again, he's not the only one I can think of. I think that's something about an artist. Although there are very macho artists out there and very gay artists out there. It's not so totally unusual to find, because as an artist you're always looking for different byways to explore, and that can lead you, I think you perforce you're open to all kinds of possibilities. I would say yes. I would say that's clearly one of the underpinnings of his mega talent, yes. And maybe the anguish that he felt produced that incredibly powerful voice, that incredibly powerful emotional voice. I mean, my mother loves Freddie. My mother, who's, you know, in her late 70s, has always said, this is a man who has the most incredible voice. I mean, partly she was interested because she knew I knew him, and this is not somebody, this is quite a conservative woman, but she recognized what. I think the thing with Freddie was it wouldn't have mattered when he was born. That voice would have had its place. It happened to be born in, you know, in the time he was born, and it was expressed in rock and roll. But in another era, it would have been expressed in the music of those particular times. This was, like I think I said earlier, this might have been on a, you know, you could argue that Bob Dylan maybe in his own way had the finest voice in rock and roll, but Bob could never have sung opera, you see. See, Freddie could have sung anything and did sing. Of course, he did sing opera, you know. So he will live forever. That's clear as day. I mean, let's be honest, Queen were not just Freddie. Brian's guitar, Roger, the harmonies were totally unique. There were never harmonies in there. But I think they would acknowledge that maybe without Freddie, it might not have become quite what it became. So without, you know, denying. And John Deacon, I mean, he wrote Another One Bites the Dust, didn't he? I mean, this is fairly muted personality, but still a great bass player and a great talent. So it was just a happy combination, and obviously the personalities meshed in a certain way that produced this such incredible music.
A last question: if you would have to sum up your personal feelings or relationship to Freddie in one sentence. Now, not the star or whatever, but what is he for you, or what was he for you as a personally? How would you do this in one sentence?
Well, he was a very empathetic person. He was somebody, I think we had a special thing, probably because I was the first visually orientated person that he felt a complete simpatico with. So, that that plus, you know, I was a very soft personality in those days too, and he was. I think we had a lot of tastes in common, in terms of the world of aesthetics, and that gave us a special thing. But of course, you know, it only lasted for a certain period for many reasons, partly because I was in America then for long periods of time, and suddenly I was into punk rock, which was a whole other thing. I remember him saying to me one day, "What's all this punk rock stuff you've been doing, Mick Rock? What's all this about?" I mean, they're just not very good looking, those. I do remember that, him complaining about the Ramones and the Dead Boys. He understood Debbie Harry, but he, and that nasty Johnny Rotten, you know. And so he, but I do remember him with great fondness and but also incredible respect for just an enormous talent. Freddie, you'll never be forgotten, that's for sure.
Thank you very much. Cut.
Okay, broad camera, please.
My name is Mick Rock, and I took a lot of the key early photos of Freddie and Queen, and Freddie was also a close friend of mine, and somebody that I had a deep fondness for.
Do you mind, can we do it again, and you do it a little
bit more? Okay. Oh, you want, I'm a friend and photographer, okay.
Something like that.
Yes.
Just a short
bit,
okay?
Yeah, my name's Mick Rock, and I, start again, sorry. I can expand on things, it's keeping it simple. My name's Mick Rock, I'm a photographer. I did a lot of key early images of Queen. And a friend of Freddie Mercury's. You want to cut that down again so I'm photographer?
No, just don't. It was fine, but please cut it down again.
Hi, my name is Mick Rock. Start again.
Okay.
Who would have thought that this would be the difficult bit?
Yeah.
With my mouth. My name is Mick Rock. I took a lot of early key images of Queen and Freddie, and was a close friend of Freddie's.
Very good. Cut. Thank you.
Shoot 35mm too? Even the little guys? Probably not.
Not now.
No, that's what I thought. So those are going to package up for you?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Ich glaube, dieses Kostüm haben wir als Entwurf gefilmt. Das war eine Anzeige für den Schnitt.